everybody. It is good to be with you today. What a blessing to have the choir starting with us. Such a blessing. Yeah, you can give them an applause for them. And I hope many of you do take up Luke on his offer to join after the service. That's going to be phenomenal. I'm sure we'll have some more information in the bulletin in the weeks to come on how you can sign up. Well, we are nearing the end of our prayer series, Echoes of Devotion, and I have had just such a blessing of a time being able to look at different prayers of the Bible, see how we can be praying them together, looking at that book by Donald Whitney. I'm not sure about you, but that's been such a blessing to me to go through it once again about praying the Bible. And in fact, this week, we're actually doing another event to kind of spark that culture of prayer among us. This past week, we had an amazing event. Who was here this past Wednesday for our prayer night? Just give a, yeah. It was absolutely amazing. It was like a good packed group, and it was really just so much fun. And this Thursday, we have a gentleman named Ken Boa, who is a prolific author, written a whole bunch of different things on prayer, on apologetics, coming to speak to us on Thursday night all about how we can pray different passages of Scripture, not just Psalms, not just prayers like we've been doing, but like how do you pray Leviticus, which I imagine most of us are like, I don't even read Leviticus, so why not learn how to pray it and get even more joy out of it? So I want to encourage you, come join us this Thursday night. You can register at the link on the QR code. It's being done in partnership with the C.S. Lewis Institute, an organization we've been partnering with more and more over the last 2 years, and I'm so excited for us to be able to be a part of that event. Please, don't miss it. You're not going to want to miss it at all. Well, I don't know about you, but choirs fill me with joy. Do they do the same for you? I don't know. There's something just about getting all together and singing. I love that. It's just a time of great exultation. Do you know what that word means, exultation? It's a lively, triumphant joy. And so I have to ask you, what makes you exult? What makes you exult, and what does it look like when you do? Do you exult in success by posting it on Instagram? Do you exult in sports by screaming at the top of your lungs and scaring your children? Do you exult in romance by doing a little happy dance? This past week, I had the blessing of going to the Lyric Opera. It's one of my favorite things to do with my father-in-law. We try and go regularly, and got to see the new show that just was on its opening night, Fidelio. It's the only opera that Beethoven actually ever wrote. And it's a dark show, but it ends in absolute exultation. You see, the opera is all about a woman named Leonore, whose husband is wrongly imprisoned. And so in order to free him, she pretends to be a male prison guard named Fidelio. And at the end of the opera, spoiler alert, as with all shows, like, the good guy wins. When Leonore is successful in freeing her husband, the whole cast breaks out into singing this beautiful song. I mean, I was telling my wife about it, and she was like, oh, I kind of would have liked that. It's the song saying, his wife has saved him. His wife has saved him. Join us with full hearts, the chorus sings. In jubilation of the righteous, innocence triumphs, lies fall, and heaven itself exacts vengeance. I think my wife really likes it because the wife saved him, which is kind of characteristic of our life. When I think of exaltation, this is what comes to mind. But what about you? Maybe for you, you can't help but think of the song by Pharrell Williams, Happy. It might seem crazy what I'm about to say. Sunshine, she's here, you can take a break. I'm a hot air balloon that could go to space with the air like I don't care, baby, by the way, because I'm happy. It's an incredibly lively, triumphant and catchy song, isn't it? Whenever I hear it, I hate to admit it, but I become, dare I say, happy. You see, friends, we were made for exultation. We were made to exult, to rejoice In Genesis, when man is no longer alone and is given a spouse, what does he do? He exults by reciting poetry. At last, bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh, I shall call her woman, for she was taken from man. When the Israelites are delivered from Egypt, what happens? Moses' sister Miriam grabs a tambourine, starts banging it and leading the people in a song of triumph. Friends, I don't know how many times we do that here, but if you have your tambourines, I think Luke would be perfectly fine with it. Just take them out. That's a joke. Luke is going to write me a note later. When Deborah is victorious over the Canaanites, she invites the people to sing in praise and exaltation. Friends, God's people are an exulting people. And the passage we're looking at today is a passage of exaltation. It exults in the changing of circumstances, like Miriam and Deborah. The passage we're looking at today is another story of a woman's exultation. Here, exulting over the end of a season of despair. A despair that's, to be honest, far too common in our world. It's the longing for a child in the midst of infertility. This prayer belongs to a woman named Hannah. And if you have a Bible, you can find it by opening up to the book of 1 Samuel. We're going to be in 1 Samuel chapter 2. 1 Samuel chapter 2. If you don't have a Bible with you, you can find one under your chairs or in the bookshelves up on the risers. And we will be on page 225 of those books. You can feel free to click or find your way over to that. But before we do that, I just want to say a quick word on the topic of infertility. Because I know that there are many here who have felt the weight of infertility in your lives or in those who are close to you. It's important to know, the Bible does not ignore this pain. I mean, many women in Scripture, Sarah, Rachel, Elizabeth, faced the sorrow of infertility. Hannah herself knew the deep heartache of waiting for a child. She felt the sting of judgment from others that maybe some in this room have felt. What I want you to know is that God heard her cries, and she hears your cries as well. Nevertheless, while God eventually gave Hannah a child, the most powerful part of her story is not the pregnancy. It's the process and the prayer that she prays when she gives him up. For those struggling with infertility today, know that God sees your pain and his love for you is unfailing. Would you pray with me before we hop in? Father, as we look at Hannah's prayer, a prayer of your faithfulness in the process, let us learn how we might exult despite despair, despite dreams lost or years of pain. We too can echo this prayer of devotion with exaltation in the midst of suffering. Teach us to do this now through the power of your Holy Spirit. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. We're actually going to start in chapter 1, if you will, just to give us some context. You see, the story begins of 1 Samuel. The context of this prayer begins in verse 1 of chapter 1. There was a certain man of Ramathaim Zophim of the hill country of Ephraim, whose name was Elkanah, the son of Jeroham, son of Elihu, son of Tohu, son of Zuph, an Ephrathite. He had two wives. The name of the one was Hannah, and the name of the other, Peninnah. And Peninnah had children, but Hannah had no children. Let me say quickly that Elkanah, having two wives, was definitely not the model given by God. In fact, much like any other place in the Bible, what we see when we see polyamory is that marriage turns to mayhem when you expand the covenant. Some think that polyamory will double the love, but my friends, what we see in Scripture is that it always triples the trouble. Such is the case with Elkanah, who unashamedly loved Hannah more than he loved Peninnah. This obviously made Peninnah bitter, as it would anyone, and so we see in verse 6 of this chapter that her rival, that is Peninnah, used to provoke Hannah grievously to irritate her because the Lord had closed her womb. You see, she mocked Hannah for her infertility. The sins of polyamory and preference are at work here. And remember, like we said last week, this sin does what it always does. Sin is a cumulative, parasitic, rebellious, corruptive, depriving, breaching of relationships that vandalizes shalom, the way that God desired for things to be. And so, in the midst of this mocking, Hannah prays. Verse 10 says that she was deeply distressed and prayed to the Lord and wept bitterly. And she vowed a vow and said, O Lord of hosts, if you will indeed look on the affliction of your servant and remember me and not forget your servant, but will give your servant a son, then I will give him to the Lord all the days of his life, and no razor shall touch his head. This is what we might call a Nazarite vow. Hannah promises that if the Lord were to give her a son, she would give him right back. He will belong to the Lord's work. I want to get to Hannah's prayer, though, so I'm going to summarize the rest of chapter 1. Please don't miss this, though. Hannah wept bitterly and was deeply distressed because of her inability to conceive. It's important to remember that for years, years, Hannah carried this burden. She went to the temple again and again, crying out to God with no sign of change. During those long seasons of waiting, her heart was heavy, but God was with Hannah in her pain. Her prayers and tears were not wasted, and her identity was not defined by her inability to have children. For those who may never experience pregnancy, Hannah's story reminds us that our value is not measured by what or who we produce. Our value is not in who we are. It's in whose we are. Though Hannah did not have the access to the promise that the Apostle Paul would later say in Romans 8, that God is working out all things for the good of those who trust him, she still held on knowing that he was working for her good. Still, Hannah was given a child, and she raised that child until the age of 3 or 4, we're told, at which point he was fully weaned. And then according to the vow she made, she brought her son Samuel to the priest named Eli to raise her son. And let's be real, I don't think any parent would have grimaced if she decided to not give up her child, if she would have reneged on the promise. It would have been wrong to do so, but it would have been entirely understandable. And yet, she presents her son Samuel in the temple, not with a prayer of lament, but a prayer of exultation. My hope in looking at this prayer today, as we finally get into it, don't worry, we're getting into it, is that we're going to see how Hannah's prayer of exultation is characterized by praise, declaration, thanksgiving, and trusting. Now, to be clear, this is not the characteristics of all prayers of exaltation. You might pray a prayer of exaltation and it doesn't include all these things, but my hope for us today is that we will learn how to echo Hannah's prayer and exult alongside of her. So let's look at her prayer together, beginning with exaltation through praise. Chapter 2, beginning in verse 1, Hannah prayed and said, "My heart exults in the Lord. My horn is exalted in the Lord. My mouth derides my enemies because I rejoice in your salvation. There is none holy like the God, for there is none beside you. There is no rock like our God." Hannah's prayer of exaltation begins with praise, but you might notice she hasn't yet said anything about what God has done for her. And the reason I make that point is because I think in the church, we often confuse praise with thanksgiving. But that's a mistake. You see, thanksgiving is about what God has done for me. Praise is about who God simply is. Exulting in God through praise is exulting in the knowledge of who he has revealed himself to be to us. For this reason, Hannah's prayer begins with three my's. Did you see that? Three my's. My heart, my horn, my mouth. Her heart exalts, her horn exalts, is exalted, and her mouth derides. Hannah's heart exults in the Lord, expressing the fullness of her being. After waiting on the Lord, her joy is finally complete. Every heartbeat echoes this triumph in exaltation. Hannah's horn is exalted. Now, and it's important to note that word exult and exalt, though they sound very similar in English, are actually completely different words in English, and they're also completely different words in Hebrew that don't even share a single Hebrew letter in common. To exult, again, is to feel triumphant elation, but to exalt is to hold something in high regard. When Hannah says that her horn is exalted, she is saying that she feels full of vigor. As a horn, like the horn of a ram or a bull, was a symbol of strength, her horn is exalted. Hannah proclaims, "My mouth derides my enemies." More literally, the text would say, her mouth is enlarged over her enemies, indicating her victory and joy in God's salvation. Hannah saying, "Lord, this is hard, but I feel untouchable." To quote Pharrell again, she's like that hot air balloon that could go into space. You see, the three my's that start this prayer should give you freedom to feel in prayer. Hannah's prayer is not to an ethereal concept. It's not to a nebulous higher power. She feels for this God. Friends, you can't praise in monotone. It's not a praise if you barely open your mouth. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. No, friends, praise is to be felt. It's to be triumphed in. There is none holy like God, Hannah goes on to say in verse 2. There is none holy like the God, for there is none beside you. There is no rock like our God. This God, Yahweh, is not like the gods of the other nations who the nations pray to. Hannah's God is a solid rock on which she stands. All other ground is sinking sand. I love the poetry in this prayer. Do you see the poetry in this verse and how it mimics the first one? First, there are three my's in verse 1, and now there's three none's. None like holy like the Lord. None beside you. In fact, the third one is also a none, but we say no in English. But it's none a rock like our God. And so as you seek to echo Hannah's prayer, I want to challenge you this morning to feel who God has revealed himself to be and pray, "Praise you, Lord, for you are." Praise you, Lord. You are our deliverer. Praise you, Lord. You are in control of all things. Look at the sheet that you got when you came in. Fill it out. How would you pray Hannah's prayer? Praise you, Lord. You are my provider. Praise you, Lord. You are my great physician. Just as Hannah's praise is rooted in deliverance, if you are a follower of Jesus present with us today, our joy is found in the ultimate deliverance of Jesus Christ. He is the one who lifts us from our sins, raising our horn through his resurrection. You might pray this morning, "Praise you, Lord. You are King. Praise you, Lord. You are the resurrection and the life." Think of the I am statements. Praise you, Lord. You are the light of the world. You are the door. Praise you, Lord. You are the truth and the way. We can echo Hannah's prayer of exaltation by joining her in praise. As we continue reading her prayer, we can see that we join her in a prayer of exaltation through praise and also declaration. Look at verse 3. Talk no more so very proudly. Let not arrogance come from your mouth, for the Lord is a God of knowledge, and by him actions are weighed. Now this is interesting, because I don't think we do this often in our prayers, do we? The prayer is shifted. No longer is she speaking just to God, but now she's speaking to those around her. And sometimes we do this in like pastoral prayers, right? Dear Lord, we pray for our church today, and I pray that everyone would sign up for the Ken Boa event on Thursday. You see, that's a little hint there. But you know, that's what she's doing. She's saying, no, we are supposed to be speaking to God as though we are speaking to God together. It's not me individually and you individually. Rather, we are all speaking to God. It's a conversation because we believe that God is truly presence. Hannah's model of exaltation encourages us to invite others into our joy, to declare to those around us. Just as we share a great song that we listened to, or a hilarious sitcom that we watched, or a fantastic restaurant. Like, we naturally want to invite people in to the things that we exult in. This is why we write reviews. We acknowledge the creators while inviting others in to join into our experience. And when we don't, we typically assume that it didn't make much of an impact. Am I right? We talk about the things that excite us. And so Hannah says, talk no more so very proudly. Let not arrogance come from your mouth. For the Lord is a God of knowledge, and by him actions are weighed. Hannah warns her listeners of the power of God that she exults in. I think it would be hard to find a better paraphrase of verse 3 than the simple lyric from the rapper Ice Cube. Hannah is calling out, you better check yourself before you wreck yourself. You see, this prayer tells those listening that Yahweh not only has power to change, but also the willingness to act. Check yourself. Power without willingness leads to prideful distance, while willingness without power is just a sentimental gesture. But God, Yahweh, is not prideful or sentimental. No, it says the bows of the mighty are broken, but the feeble bind on strength. You see, human power is nothing compared to God's authority. The day is coming when God will humble the proud and exalt the humble. It's like what we sang just a little bit ago when Luke led us and the choir led us. Behold, he comes riding on the cloud. We look for this day. Friends, the bow that Hannah is talking about, the bow was the fiercest weapon available in the ancient Near East in the days of Hannah. It was the ancient AK-47. And Hannah says her God will snap them. Meanwhile, those who are feeble, more literally those who are broken, they will be made strong. Through God's breaking, he will bring healing. Those who were full have hired themselves out for bread, the text says, but those who were hungry have ceased to hunger. The wealthy who once had plenty now find themselves in need, while the hungry are satisfied. The proud and self-sufficient are brought low, while the humble and needy are raised up. Keep reading with me at verse 6. The Lord kills and brings to life. He brings down to Sheol and raises up. The Lord makes poor and makes rich. He brings low and he exalts. He raises up the poor from the dust. He lifts the needy from the ash heap to make them sit with princes and inherit a seat of honor. Friends, I hope that if you are a follower of Christ who has been meditating on the word, that perhaps you might bring to mind the book of Ephesians, which says that we are now in Christ, seated with him in the heavenly places. This prayer has been answered in Jesus, and we can pray it. It's ours. You see, Hannah's declaration is not only a warning for the oppressor, it is hope for the oppressed. For the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and on him he has set the world. You see, nothing in all of creation is outside of his control. You see, it's easy, I think, sometimes for us to lose sight of this, to think that because we have experienced some form of pain, that we have a greater vantage point on which to look at the world, we throw around phrases like, well, no one knows what I've been through. And you can't possibly know what I know. Listen, suffering can provide perspective. It can. But we must be cautious to claim absolute truth because of our suffering. Hannah's prayer reminds us that our view, no matter what it is that we have been through, is limited. As humans, we can only ever see 180 degrees at once, almost 200 with peripheral. But only God can see 360. Corrie ten Boom, a Dutch Christian watchmaker who was sent to the Ravensbrück Nazi concentration camp after being convicted of hiding Jewish people in her home, often quoted an anonymous poem that I love. I'm going to read it to you. She says that my life is but a weaving between my God and me. I cannot choose the colors he weaveth steadily. Oft times he weaveth sorrow and I in foolish pride. Forget he sees the upper and I the underside. Not till the loom is silent and the shuttles cease to fly will God unroll the canvas and reveal the reason why. The dark threads are as needful in the weaver's skillful hand as the threads of gold and silver in the pattern he has planned. He knows, he loves, he cares. Nothing this truth can dim. He gives the very best to those who leave the choice to him. That second to last verse that haunts me. The dark threads are as needful in the weaver's skillful hand as the threads of gold and silver in the pattern he has planned. You see, Hannah's prayer reminds us that God, in his wisdom, controls both the joy and the sorrow, the strength and the weakness. Her declaration thus challenges us to look beyond our own struggles and acknowledge God's sovereign hand in all things, inviting and joining others in exulting in him. You see, just as Hannah proclaimed God's greatness, let's make it personal. We can declare, Lord, I love how you turned my weakness into strength. I love how you provided when I had nothing. I love how you gave me hope when I was in despair. Lord, I love how you healed me when I had given up. How is God working in your life right now? Where do you see his sovereign reversals? What prayers have you seen answered in the last few weeks? Perhaps this is a moment where you ought to recognize that you have not been praying as you ought. And so you have not seen the answers to prayers that God is offering. Echo Hannah's prayer of exaltation then. Lord, I love how you. Join her in praise. Join her in declaration. And then join her in thanksgiving. Exaltation through thanksgiving. You might notice here that there's, in the prayer as a whole, there's actually no explicit phrase, thank you. And yet, her gratitude for God's intervention permeates the entirety of the prayer, doesn't it? You see, gratitude is not just saying thank you. I mean, we've all received gifts that we didn't actually want and said, thank you, haven't we? No, gratitude is the joyful acknowledgement of another's blessing. Stop for a moment and recognize when it was that Hannah prayed this prayer. She exults in gratitude at the moment she is giving away the son that she so desperately longed for. You see, before this child was even born, Hannah learned a lesson that most parents learn far too late, that every good and perfect gift is from above, and that includes our children. Gratitude, a joyful acknowledgement of another's blessing, allows Hannah to recognize that her son, Samuel, is not her own. Recognizing these sovereign reversals, most specifically that the barren has borne seven, but she who has many children is forlorn. is what empowers her gratitude so that she might have the strength to give what was never truly hers to begin with. Friends, you see, when we withhold gratitude, what happens is the exact opposite begins to form within us. Greed, ungenerosity. When we withhold thanks for the Lord's provision, what will happen is that we always will become protective. But Hannah, with her toddler in her arms and gratitude in her heart, is able to pray, "The barren has borne 7, but she who has many children is forlorn." Look again, she prays, "The barren has borne 7. And yet we know from history, if you look at the rest of 1 Samuel 2, she doesn't bear 7. No, I mean, she does have more children. The Lord visited Hannah, it says in 1 Samuel 2:21, and she conceived and bore 3 sons and 2 daughters, which is 6 if you do the math. I do know a little bit of math, even though I went to Bible college and seminary. So why does she say 7? The number 7 is symbolic in Hebrew poetry for completion and fullness. Though Hannah was giving away the one son that God had given her, God's generosity had already taught her that she was whole. What are you unable to let go of, my friends? What if taken away would make you question your identity and sense of wholeness? Whatever that is, be it a person or a possession, is something that you are probably not truly grateful for. True gratitude, you see. True gratitude isn't about the object. It's about the subject. It's not about what has been given, but the one who gives. What might you need to express gratitude for and thanksgiving for? Where might you joyfully acknowledge the Lord's blessing over something that you hold sacred? Name it. Friends, name it and say, "Lord, I thank you for. Lord, I thank you for my home. Lord, I thank you for my savings account. Lord, I thank you for my job. Lord, I thank you for my marriage or my children. Lord, I thank you for my friends who you have brought around me here in this city. But Lord, I will not hold them. I will not hold that savings account. I will not hold those friends. I will not hold this job. I'll have my hands wide open, recognizing that it is you who gives and it is you who takes away. And yet, as the book of Job says, blessed be the name of the Lord." You see, when we thank him, when we proclaim his blessings, we proclaim that we are not owned by what we own, but simply stewards of what he has given. We join Hannah's prayer of exaltation in echoing her praise, her declaration, her thanksgiving, and lastly, I want us to look at her trusting. Exaltation through trust. You see, Hannah concludes her prayer by expressing trust in God's ongoing rule in the world. Look at verse 9 through 10. "He will guard the feet of his faithful ones, but the wicked shall be cut off in darkness, for not by might shall a man prevail. The adversaries of the Lord shall be broken to pieces. Against them he will thunder in heaven. The Lord will judge the ends of the earth. He will give strength to his king and exalt the horn of his anointed." What's perhaps, I think, most remarkable about Hannah's prayer is not that she trusts God for more children, no, but that she trusts God for an anointed king. You see, at this point in Israel's history, there was no king. Neither Saul nor David had yet to be anointed king. In fact, at this point, they weren't even born yet. And in case you didn't know, it was actually Hannah's son, Samuel, who would be the one that would anoint both of those men king. Nevertheless, with no king to give strength to, Hannah prays, trusting that God will give strength to his not yet king and exalts the horn of his anointed. See, many have pointed out that the last line is what makes Hannah's prayer turn into a prophecy. This is the first occurrence, actually, of the word anointed being associated with a king in the Hebrew Bible. And the Hebrew word for anointed is one that I imagine most of you here are probably quite familiar with. It's the word Mashiach, Messiah. The Lord will judge the ends of the earth. He will give strength to his king and exalt the horn of his Mashiach. Hannah's prayer begins and ends with the raising of a horn. Do you see that? First as a symbol of her strength, and then as a symbol of the strength of her Messiah king. Her prayer arose from a place of emptiness and deep anguish. Yet through her faith, she experienced miraculous filling, transforming her sorrow into exultation. This prayer actually becomes the prayer of a woman named Mary, who would be the mother of that Mashiach king. Mary borrows a lot from Hannah's prayer. If you look at her prayer in Luke 1, 46 to 55, like Hannah, Mary prays in a posture of emptiness, not barrenness, but virginity. Mary exults with Hannah, entrusting the word of the Lord to fill her with grace. You see, both women rejoice in God's fulfillment and faithfulness. Both women illustrate the heart of exaltation, where personal experiences of God's goodness fuel our prayers. They show us that even in our emptiness, whether it be in our spirits, our hopes, or our lives, we are invited to trust in the Lord who fills us beyond our expectations. And as followers of Christ, friends, we find ourselves in similar positions. We were once empty of God, lost in our sin, void of purpose. When people can no longer believe the promises of the leaders of this world, when provisions fail to be delivered, when the rich get richer and the poor get poorer, this prayer voices an alternative to which the desperate faithful can cling, so that our prayers, like Hannah's and Mary's, are not merely reflections of our circumstances, but declarations of trust in God's transformative power. And so, with Hannah, friends, I want to invite you to pray, Lord, I trust you will. Lord, I trust you will. How will you complete that sentence? I trust you'll bring justice and judgment. Lord, I trust that you will restore all things. Lord, I trust that you will wipe every tear away from our eyes in the age to come. Lord, I trust that you will raise us to eternal life, just as you raised Jesus from the dead. Lord, I trust that the wicked will not prosper. Lord, I trust that you will. Personalize it. Church, as God's people, we are called to be an exalting people. Just as Hannah exulted in God, we too are invited to lift our voices to praise the Father, declare the Son, thank Jesus, and trust God, knowing that our God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. You know, for over 300 years, there's been a hymn of exultation that has been echoed through churches across the world. A song rooted in the same spirit of prayer and trust that we see in Hannah's prayer. Its author, a man named Thomas Ken, was no stranger to hardship. Orphaned at a young age, Ken was raised by his older sister and her husband, who nurtured in him a love for God and learning. In his adult life, Ken served in many prestigious roles, even as chaplain to Princess Mary, and later King Charles II. Yet his unwavering commitment to Christ set him apart. When the king's mistress sought to lodge in his home, Ken refused. Standing firm in his faith, many thought, surely this guy's going to get fired or worse, beheaded. But in an unexpected turn, he was rewarded for his boldness, and that very king gave him a bishopric. You see, Ken's life was a life of hardship and uncertainty. But like Hannah, what he is most known for is his prayer of exaltation. It's a 14-stanza song that is simply called the Morning Hymn, of which the last stanza of exaltation has been sung by billions of Christians in different languages all over the world. And I want you to listen to it. I'm going to have Luke actually sing it for us, and then we'll join him in singing it after. Sing for us, Luke.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. And praise him, all creatures here below. And praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. And praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
This hymn by Thomas Ken, like Hannah's prayer, reminds us of the power of lifting our voices in praise and thanksgiving to the God who faithfully leads, provides, and fulfills his promises. Friends, it doesn't matter how dark the clouds are. The sun still shines above them. God is worthy to be exalted in. Would you stand? Let's sing that little verse again together. Let's sing it.
And praise God from whom all blessings flow.
Come on, sing this.
Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. And praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Sing amen.
Lord, we sing this.
Amen.
Declare it.
We sing
praise you, Lord. You are our strength and deliverer, the one who raises the humble from the dust. Praise you, Lord. You are the holy and mighty, the sovereign God who rules over all creation. Lord, I love how you fill the empty and provide for those who trust in you, just as you did for Hannah. Lord, we thank you for the ways that you work in our lives, filling our emptiness with your grace. Lord, we thank you for the gift of salvation through Jesus Christ, who brings hope to the hopeless. And Lord, we trust you. We trust that you will sustain us through every trial as our refuge and strength. We trust you that you will take even these broken prayers and through your Holy Spirit, tune them to your heart as your will. Lord, that you would tune our hearts to yours. Praise you.